Labdien, ļoti godīgi.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, everyone watching us. Fine arts, where Foreign Minister of the Republic of Latvia met with his U.S. colleague. We'll start with a statement by Mr. Rinkevich. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen.
Welcome back. Cerīgi, man ir tiešām šodien gods šeit.
And indeed, today I had the honor to welcome my U.S. counterpart here in the... In December, when the foreign ministers of NATO countries met here in Riga, we couldn't have imagined we would meet so soon again. It is always, of course, a big pleasure to meet with our American friends, but we are currently meeting in very grave circumstances, and we discussed a broad range of issues, of course, primarily our support and assistance to Ukraine. Assured my... with our allies and the United States of America. We also talked about more efficient ways of countering Russian aggression. We also discussed potential tightening of sanctions. But sanctions are not only do have to be imposed, but they also have to be all assets, all kinds of real estate and movable property and transatlantic bonded cooperation is absolutely essential in this regard, and we will continue working with our colleagues in the EU as well as in the United States on further sanctions. We also talked about further reinforcement of the eastern flank of NATO and reinforcement or strength. To our security and have also contributed additionally to our security more recently. Of course, looking at the most recent developments, we are very happy about the permanent presence of U.S. forces here in Latvia. We have no illusions about Putin's Russia anymore. I don't really see any reason, any good reason to see that we need to also support journalists or media in Russia and Belarus who represent free independent media, not only by helping them leave their country and also facilitating their work here or and not from Russian propaganda channels, and we also agreed to cooperate on that as well. That is as far as my introduction goes. Now I'd like to hand it over to Anthony Blinken.
Edgars, thank you very, very much. And indeed, it's always good to be back, but I wish it was under different circumstances. Doing together in recent weeks, particularly the work that's been made necessary by Russia's aggression against Ukraine. I should note that we're here now in what is the 100th anniversary year of diplomatic relations between the United States and Latvia. When we were here a few months ago for the NATO meetings, I reflected at the time on how strong between our countries has grown, especially in the last 30 years since Latvia's independence, rooted in a shared commitment to democracy, to human rights, to the rule of law. And I said that while those principles can feel a little bit abstract at times, we were seeing serious challenges to them by autocratic governments that were seeking to erode the international rules-based order that is so to peace and security. Well, That abstraction has become, unfortunately, 3 months later, a very, very powerful reality. And any question of how vital it is, I think, has been put to rest. Since Russia's unprovoked and unjustified invasion of Ukraine began, hundreds of civilians have been killed, hundreds more wounded. As of today, more than 1.5 million people, mostly women and children, have had to flee Ukraine, flee their homes. Many more people are trying to flee, but they cannot get out of besieged areas. In the last several days, more strikes have killed and wounded civilians as they try to leave the cities that are being surrounded by Russian forces. Women and children, the elderly, wounded civilians, people with disabilities, are trying to escape cities where there's no heat, no electricity, relentless bombardment, and where they're running out of food and medicine. And there have continued to be reports of attacks by Russian forces on agreed-upon humanitarian corridors. We've seen scenes like this before in Europe. Every Russian has lived or learned about the horrific siege of Leningrad during World War II, in which that city's civilian population was systematically starved and intentionally destroyed over nearly 900 days, leading to hundreds of thousands of deaths. That siege affected millions of Russian families, including President Putin's, whose one-year-old brother was one of the many victims. Now, Russia is starving out the world is saying to Russia, stop these attacks immediately. Let the food and medicine in. Let the people out safely and end this war of choice against Ukraine. Latvians who lived through decades of Soviet occupation understand deeply how wrong this is and how the world must defend Ukraine's right to exist as a sovereign, democratic country free to choose its own. Provided critical security assistance to Ukraine, including Stinger missiles, anti-tank weapons, small arms, ammunition, protective gear, medical supplies. And the Latvian people have stepped forward as well, with an outpouring of humanitarian donations, a pledge to welcome more than 10,000 refugees from Ukraine into their homes and into their communities. Latvia and the United States, together with our allies and partners, will continue to stand with Ukraine. Our security to the Ukrainian people, both those still inside Ukraine and those who have had to flee. We're raising the costs on the Kremlin and all who aid and enable it for continuing this war. We're also bolstering our shared defense. We and our NATO allies are prepared to meet any threat. President Biden spoke to the American people just a few days ago in his State of the Union. We will defend every inch of NATO territory against aggression coming from anywhere at any time. Our commitment to Article 5, an attack on one is an attack on all, is ironclad. The President has called it sacrosanct, and no one should have any doubt about that. NATO activated our defense bank. Increased their troop presence and contributed additional equipment and capabilities to this effort. President Biden ordered the deployment of an additional 7,000 U.S. troops to Europe and moved forces already in Europe to NATO's eastern flank, including to Latvia. We now have more than 1,000 U.S. soldiers here in Latvia. We'll continue to rotate our forces to Latvia and the Baltic region to train alongside the NATO enhanced NATO's enhanced air policing mission. We're also working with Latvia and Baltic partners on security in other realms, cybersecurity to protect critical infrastructure against malicious actors, and energy security so that Latvia's energy supply is not dependent on Russia. Latvia hosts the NATO Strategic Communications Center of Excellence, a critical to identify it. Our collaboration in these areas is quite simply more important than ever, and I look forward to continuing that. This is my second stop in a visit to all three Baltic countries. Over the past 30 years, the Baltics have formed a democratic wall that is now standing against the tide of more committed than ever to standing with you as our democracies rise to the challenge of this moment. It's very moving to see the blue and yellow colors of the Ukrainian flag in this city, in Lithuania, where I just came from, on public monuments, homes, schools, businesses. Latvia, the United States, and many countries in Europe and around the world. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Segre. You'll be needing your interpreting now. Mēs pārējām pie jautājumiem.
Now we move to questions and answers and Latvian television in Strasdiņa. Thank you for this opportunity. In Strasdiņa, Latvian television, I would like to ask Mr. Renkevich, first of all, you already mentioned the having troops in Latvia standing. Have you discussed it with Mr. Blinken, the possibility to increase the troops here in Latvia and have permanently deployed American soldiers here in Latvia? And what was the answer given to you? And the question to Mr. Blinken, closing the skies, this is what Ukraine is demanding very intensively. NATO has provided its explanation that it would complicate the situation even more, turning this. But you look at the countries have been given green light to give planes to the states, and Poland was mentioned that you had offered substitute fleet to Poland if it offered its planes to Ukraine, but the answer is not clear. What could be the practical solution to this, a practical assistance to Ukraine in defending its sky? I have to say, thank you for the question. Indeed, we discussed the matter, how to force the presence of NATO forces and also of the United States as part of NATO here in the region, and I underscored that I would like to have permanent solutions to this, seeing the way this situation is developing. And of course, my colleague will add to what I'm saying, because it wouldn't be right to retell the opinion of his opinion himself, and yet we agreed that both the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Defense, while preparing for NATO summit in Madrid, preparing the new strategic concept, responding to the change in the situation, we are going to work on what Anthony said, to have effective protection of all NATO states, what with the measures that would be needed, and the presence should be as long constant Putin's regime is, as constant this presence is going to be, and even beyond it, perhaps.
I very much agree with what Edgar has said. Just a couple of things in response to the question. First, as I noted, we have, and NATO has, already significantly reinforced the eastern flank, including right here in Latvia. Of the F-35 strike fighter planes. We're doing this in close partnership with NATO allies. Canada, of course, is playing a lead role here in Latvia. We also are, on a regular basis, reviewing our global posture. And that will continue. And of course, as we do that, we have to factor in so all of that will factor into our thinking, into our decisions about what we do going forward. And of course, we're working on all of these issues within the NATO alliance. That's vital as well. Second, it's very important to note everything that has been done and continues to be done to help the Ukrainians. To Ukraine. Just within the last couple of weeks, President Biden created the authority to provide an additional $350 million in defense support to Ukraine. And within a week, most of that, about 70%, is already in the hands of Ukrainians, being used very effectively. The aid of $10 billion. And that $10 billion, which I believe Congress will provide very quickly, will go to additional security assistance for Ukraine. It will go to humanitarian assistance for Ukraine, both inside Ukraine and outside. And it will go to further efforts to reinforce NATO's eastern flank. So all of that is ongoing. In what they're doing, which is defending their country against this Russian aggression. That's what we're focused on, and our military experts are focused on. I've talked about, and Secretary General of NATO have talked about the question of the no-fly zone before. And just to be clear and to all I want to do is to widen it, and to widen it to our own countries, to our own territory. The no-fly zone, to be very clear about what that involves, is that means that if Russian planes violate the zone that's declared, in the interest of the Ukrainian people. But, and I want to repeat this very clearly, when it comes to any aggression of any kind against NATO territory by Russia or anyone else for that matter, we are absolutely committed to the defense of that territory, every square inch. And President Biden has made that repeatedly clear as well.
Thank you very much, Mr. Secretary. Wall Street Journal, William Malden, please.
Thank you very much for doing this. For Minister Rynkevich, you mentioned effective protection is needed for Latvia and the Baltic countries. What constitutes effective protection? Did you ask for any new types of military hardware or others? And did that include anti-aircraft systems? And did the U.S. seem willing to provide it? Secretary Blinken, you have upcoming meetings with Foreign Minister Lapid of Israel, with President Macron of France. What role does Israel play, especially in any possible mediation or engagement with Russia during this conflict? And do you have any message to send to Russia, other than the general need to de-escalate or stop fighting in Ukraine? And then just to clarify one thing you said earlier in Vilnius, you mentioned more permanent basing of troops here. Does that mean there is a decision or there isn't a decision to base troops permanently here in the Baltics countries specifically? And because there was a little bit of ambiguity with that, and so we're just very curious. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll answer in English. Well, yes, indeed, we discussed the further steps when it comes to providing efficient protection. And we see the need, and we are also learning from what is happening in Ukraine. We are seeing what Russians are doing after our air defense. That's absolutely clear. We also feel that we need to bolster our coastal defense, cyber defense, and we are discussing and talking not only with the Secretary of State, but also with the Secretary of Defense. We see the willingness to work with us and to look into the needs, and of course that requires some process, but I'm pretty confident that they to address some of those issues. But let me also mention another thing that is equally important than defense, and that's energy. I think that what we all understand that we need to work, and it is not only Latvia or Lithuania or Estonia, that's entire European Union, Europe as a whole, we need to work to reduce dependency on Russian gas and oil. We discussed at some can play a critical role, and we are willing to continue. In this region, this is disconnecting from Russian-Belarusian electricity grid and connecting to European electricity grid. Some work is being done. And also that means, of course, reducing dependency on gas, but here we need a bit wider effort through LNG, through renewable energy issues. So I would put now military defense and energy defense on an equal footing. We do work on those issues, yes, we do work, but I think that we will not go into details before there are no substantive efforts, and we are working through NATO and with our partners on some additional needs that, we see we need, and I'm very glad that both NATO and our partners are addressing those challenges seriously.
As I said, and as I just mentioned again now, we're on a regular basis reviewing the global posture of our forces, to include, of course, here in Europe, and we have to factor in any developments, any changes in the threat, and we will do that. And when it comes to the review of our posture, but just to be very clear, no, there's no decision of that kind. I was just saying that this is a question that's come up, and we'll, in the context of doing reviews of our posture in Europe and elsewhere, be looking at that. Second, with regard to meetings, I'm not going to get ahead of them. I'll let them more or less speak for themselves once I've had a chance. There's certainly no change in our message to Moscow, our message to Russia, to President Putin, and the war. End it now.
Thank you very much, Mr. Secretary of State, Your Excellency Minister, dear media representatives. This concludes our press conference.